25-year-old Julia was returning home in a bad mood. For the past month, she had been working as a nurse in a clinic and couldn't get used to the atmosphere in the department. The job itself was routine. The same day-to-day, human ailments and suffering did not bring joy, and her colleagues were unpleasant people with constant talks about money, gifts, and expensive things. There was never any talk about the human soul, morality, empathy, or understanding. Julia was rushing home because it was already late. She had stayed at work longer than usual, dreaming that soon she would find a job she loved and join a good team. Outside the window, it was late autumn, a gloomy, bleak time of year. She felt the same gloominess in her soul. The last bus had long since left, and Julia was forced to take the subway home. As she descended the stairs of the underground passage, she saw a skinny guy in worn, dirty clothes. He stood against the wall with his trembling hand extended, asking passers-by to give him some money. Probably a homeless guy, Julia thought. She herself grew up in a poor family without a father. Her mother worked three jobs so they could live no worse than others. Therefore, the guy evoked her sincere sympathy, especially since his face was pleasant with regular features. Julia took a few steps towards the man, and as she approached, she could see his face better. For a moment, she thought she had met her ex-boyfriend Anthony, whom she really liked. They had dated for a long time but had broken up very painfully. "Anthony!" Julia called out to the guy. He seemed to lift his head, but then immediately lowered his eyes. "It's definitely him. He's just embarrassed to be here and in such a state," Julia thought. She, by the way, had secretly hoped for a meeting all this time they hadn't seen each other. And here it happened. Julia loved Anthony, but her mother decided otherwise. Constant nagging that he wasn't her match, endless reproaches that the boy was supposedly poor and without prospects, and Anthony left, deeply offended by everyone. "What a meeting, Anthony. I recognized you and am so glad to see you," Julia stammered. "Miss, you're mistaken. Unfortunately, I'm Jacob, Jake for short." The guy barely squeezed out of himself and turned away. Julia kept looking at him and thought, "What if I take him home? To spite my mother? And tell her that he's her fiancé and now he'll live with us? Maybe after that she'll stop interfering with my personal life and suggesting suitable candidates, in her opinion." The idea was, of course, wild, and Julia already imagined the terrible scandal that would ensue at home. But for some reason, she was in such a foul mood today that she really wanted to go through with it no matter what. She bought coffee and a pastry and handed them to the vagabond. He thanked her shyly and eagerly started eating. Meanwhile, Julia began to ask him, "Jake, how did you end up here? Why aren't you working? Where is your home?" The guy, terribly embarrassed, replied, "Well, it just happened. I don't really want to talk about it. My mother drinks. She brought a stepfather home. He beat me mercilessly. It wasn't a home, but ruins. And then they kicked me out altogether. So now I wander. I have no documents. And you can't get a job without them. I sleep wherever I can, sometimes at the station, sometimes on a heating main like everyone else." Julia suddenly felt an indescribable pity for this poor guy, who, by the will of fate, was left with nothing. She blurted out immediately, "Come with me, I'll feed you dinner, you can wash up, get some rest. Just one condition. I'll tell my mother that you're my fiancé. Otherwise, she won't let you in. Well, what do you say? And if you don't like it or get bored, you can leave at any moment. No one is holding you. Please, I really need your help. Mom has been really nagging me lately, making life unbearable. She won't let me meet anyone, always finding fault. She keeps dreaming that I'll bring home a millionaire on a white horse." The stranger hesitated a bit, then said, "So, you decided to bring a homeless guy home to spite her? Well, that's an idea, to be honest. Thank you for the offer. You have a kind heart. But you know, I think I'll agree. I'm completely frozen in the passage, to be honest. It'll be nice to warm up a bit." In Julia's soul, everything suddenly brightened, and everything around seemed to light up with bright colors. She was of an emotional nature, lived by feelings. She never dreamed of a profitable marriage, a rich groom, and believed that this is not the main thing between young people. Love and mutual understanding should come first. "What if this is my destiny? I'll just tell my mother straight up that he's my fiancé. Let it be what it will be." The girl resolutely took the stunned vagabond by the arm and confidently strode towards future happiness in front of the astonished public. It must be said that Julia's mother did not welcome her daughter and the stranger very warmly, as expected. She had long suffered from high blood pressure and even once had a heart attack on her feet, resulting in disability. The doctors said she needed heart surgery to change some valve, but where to find the money for that? Life was not a joy to her anyway, but the main thing she dreamed of was seeing her daughter wealthy and happy. All her life, Mrs. Harrison barely made ends meet, grabbing any odd jobs just to have enough for food and utilities. By the end of her life, she completely ruined her health, hence all the diseases came out. Of course, she did not want Julia to repeat her miserable fate. After all, in her youth, Mrs. Harrison had suffered greatly from a great and pure love, left alone without a frivolous groom and with a huge belly. Her ideal picture of happiness, the daughter bathes in luxury and her husband is a cool businessman. Then she could die peacefully. The woman was simply stunned when she saw some ragamuffin next to her daughter and thought, why did the daughter drag him home? Dirty clothes, unwashed head, himself somewhat unkempt. The whole range of feelings from surprise to indignation appeared on her face. But Julia tried not to notice this, calmly introduced the stranger. Mom, meet him. This is my fiancé, Jake. Now he will live with us. He has nowhere else. You don't mind, do you? Turning to the guy, the girl cheerfully said, well, why are you standing as if you're rooted to the spot? Come in, don't be shy. Feel at home. The mother grumbled angrily. But don't forget, you're a guest. God, daughter, when will you stop picking up all the riffraff? We have a decent apartment, not a shelter for the homeless. The woman sighed sorrowfully and, hunching over, went to her room. Julia fried potatoes with mushrooms and the young ones had a hearty dinner. Then she took Jake to the bathroom, threw his dirty clothes into the washing machine and showed him his room. You'll sleep here next to me on a fold-out bed. I'll make the bed for you now. Jake enjoyed the hot shower, clean bed and thought to himself, what beauty. That's when you start to appreciate simple human joys. Who would have thought that I would have to experience all this? He gratefully looked at Julia before sleep and sincerely said, thank you. From the bottom of my heart. Good night, my fairy. Jake quickly settled in as a guest, and the girl's kindness played a positive role. Moreover, Julia was quite attractive herself, smiley and welcoming. The young people got along great and talked for a long time. Jake tried to help with something around the house, fixed a long fallen clothesline attachment on the balcony, tightened skewed kitchen cabinets, and stabilized shaky chairs. Julia now ran home with all her might, knowing that Jake was waiting for her. Feelings between them flared up quite unexpectedly. That evening, as usual, they watched some series and talked about everything. Suddenly Julia winced from severe pain and screamed. Concerned, Jake rushed to her. Julia, what's wrong? Are you in pain? What happened? The girl clutched her leg. Ouch! A cramp caught me. Probably ran around too much during the shift. Ouch, how it hurts. Jake took off her slipper and started gently and softly massaging her foot, then the other, then her calves. It was so pleasant. The pain immediately went away, and the cramp released her. The guy timidly began to move higher, moved closer to Julia, and started to kiss her passionately and skillfully. The girl tried to overcome herself and whispered, Jake, what are you doing? We're supposed to be pretend fiancé and bride, right? Stop. The guy quietly replied, continuing to gently caress her. I thought it was pretend too, but I fell in love for real. Julia, I want you so much. You're the best. I've never met anyone like you. If you're against it, just say the word and I'll leave right away. But it was too late. Julia had completely lost her head, and both plunged into the depths of passion, not noticing anything around them. The young people were absolutely happy. And even the eternal dissatisfaction of the mother did not irritate them at all. Jake fell so in love with Julia that he couldn't imagine life without her. And as for Julia, there's no need to say. She realized she had found her happiness. This is it, true love. How good I feel with him, it's unbelievable. She tried to convince her mother of this, but she was unyielding. Daughter, what are you doing? What future do you have with him? He's a vagabond. No documents, no property. What are you thinking? Make sure he's gone in a week. Although Jake helped the mother in every possible way, cared for her, did everything around the house, and male hands were oh so needed, the woman still hated him fiercely. She tried to insult and hurt him more painfully every time. When Jake did not leave after a week, the senior decided to go all in. While Julia was at work, she directly and angrily told Jake, "Just so you know, Groom, Julia is a crazy girl. She just decided to have fun with you. In fact, she has a fiancé. He's just currently on a trip abroad. When he comes back, he'll sort you both out. Leave immediately if you want to live. Otherwise, I'll send a telegram to Julia's fiancé right today." The mother knew she was sinning by blackening her daughter so badly. But the desire to see her daughter next to a rich man prevailed. The guy took the words seriously. He looked at the woman with eyes full of pain and suffering, then covered his face with his hands and quietly cried. He so did not want to believe what the mother had told him. Could Julia really have treated him so cruelly, after assuring him that she loved him? Could she really have betrayed him? It can't be. His whole body seemed to petrify. His legs didn't want to move. Barely, he moved from the spot and wandered off without looking back. That day, to Julia's annoyance, she had to stay overnight at the hospital because her shift was during the day. However, in the evening, a 5-year-old boy with severe burns was brought in, and they asked her to stay until morning. Julia called home and warned that she was staying overnight. The mother didn't tell her anything about having kicked out the vagabond. On the contrary, she rubbed her hands with glee, realizing that after a day he would already be far away. Jake wanted not to leave and wait for Julia to talk to her personally. His heavy experiences literally scorched his soul. He dug through his thoughts, wondering why and how this could have happened to him. But then his sense of self-respect flared up in him, and he decided, "I'll leave. I won't torment my soul or hers. Let them live as they want. Who am I to them? Just a regular bum." When Julia finally got home and didn't find Jake, she immediately understood everything. She started yelling at her mother, "Mom, why? I know you kicked him out. Are you doing this on purpose? I love Jake, do you understand? Where am I supposed to find him now?" The mother went on the defensive. "It's always my fault with you. Your bum left on his own. I didn't touch him. I personally won't cry over him. You fell in love. You'll fall out of love. Maybe you'll find a decent fiancé for the third time. How much riffraff can you bring in, and who did you take after to be like this?" Julia was in shock. She understood Jake couldn't have just left on his own. Everything was going so well. She cried, "I imagine what Mom told him about me. Where am I supposed to look for Jake now? I can't live without him." Hoping to find Jake again and explain everything to him, Julia immediately turned around and rushed to the passage where they first met. She looked around, asked other vagrants and vendors, but they just shrugged their shoulders. The guy hadn't been seen here for a long time. The girl ran around the outskirts for an hour, thinking maybe Jake didn't go far and was waiting for her somewhere nearby. But it was all in vain. The guy had vanished into thin air. She suddenly felt so wronged. Why did he do this? Why didn't he wait for her and talk it out properly? He said he loved her, and then he just took off forever. Turns out he used her and left. It was pouring rain outside. Sharp gusts of wind tore the last clinging leaves from the trees. But Julia didn't notice any of it. She walked without seeing the road, soaked to the bone, and wept inconsolably. "Maybe Mom is right, and I'm really defective, unsound. Maybe to hell with this love. Who needs it if it only brings tears? You can't trust anyone." Our heroine finally froze, got soaked, and fell seriously ill. She lay with a high fever for 3 weeks, delirious, barely recovered. In her delirium, she kept shouting Jake's name, calling for him, searching for him. Julia fell into a deep depression. She went to work like a robot, immediately locked herself in her room upon returning home, and cried until morning. She lost weight and ate poorly. After a month, the girl started feeling very nauseous, literally turning inside out. Julia was a medic and understood everything immediately. She was pregnant. The situation was a nightmare. The child's father was a vagabond who had run away in an unknown direction. Her mother barely tolerated her as it was, and if she found out about the pregnancy, she would completely disown her. What to do? How to live on? And most importantly, why Julia did not know. She now went to that same passage every morning and evening like to work and kept looking out for her Jake. Once she even thought she recognized him from the back, joyfully called out, "Jake, Jake, I finally found you!" But an entirely unfamiliar man turned around and replied in surprise, "I'm not Jake, you've mistaken me." In despair, Julia decided on an irreversible act. She saw no other way out with the child under her heart. This way, all her problems would be solved in one fell swoop, out of sight, out of mind. She went to the gynecologist, submitted the necessary tests. As a healthcare worker, she was allowed to skip the queue. When she was already lying on the chair, and the stern doctor, clearly looking at her with judgment, took out all the necessary instruments, a terrible thought pierced her. What am I doing? I'm about to kill Jakey's baby. It's his part, his blood and flesh. This baby will remind me of the dearest person all my life. How will I live after this? There it is, the meaning of life. To hell with them all, and the mother, and Jake himself, and the evil colleagues who openly laughed at her. To hell with it. I will give birth and raise him myself. Against all odds. Julia abruptly pushed the stunned doctor away, got up from the chair and muttered, "Sorry, I've changed my mind." The gynecologist sighed with relief. "Thank God. Come in a week to register for prenatal care. Just please don't delay." No. Julia came home after her shift, and the smell of fried fish hit her nose immediately. She barely managed to cover her mouth with her hand and ran to the bathroom. She was sick for half an hour. The worried mother listened at the door, suspecting the worst. She yelled, "Sweetie, are you feeling ill? Maybe you got poisoned. Open the door. It's not what I think, is it?" Finally, Julia was relieved and, utterly exhausted, came out into the corridor. The mother stood silently, looking at her with reproach, waiting for an explanation. The tired woman angrily shouted right in her mother's face, "Yes, Mom, I'm pregnant. Imagine, such a fool. And from Jake. And you drove him away. Now your grandson will never know who his father is. I hope you're happy. That's what you wanted, right? I'm not going to have an abortion. Don't even start that talk. Now leave me alone. I need to lie down." And she ran into her room crying. Mrs. Harrison clutched her heart and went to the kitchen to drink some sedatives. She mentally scolded her daughter for all she was worth. What a fool. Got herself into love. Repeating my fate. Silly, utterly silly. Stepping on the same rakes. And now what? Again to breed poverty. I barely raised her, hoping to find peace in my old age, and now we'll be raising a fatherless grandson. From that day on, Julia and her mother hardly spoke. She became withdrawn and never left her room. She tried not to cry when it became unbearable. She would start stroking her belly and quietly sing a lullaby or talk to the baby. Strangely enough, it helped, and she began to calm down and fall asleep. Mrs. Harrison regretted 1,000 times that she had slandered her daughter and driven Jake away. The guy was, in truth, not bad. Non-drinking, industrious, and loved Julia very much, it was visible to the naked eye. They could have gotten him documents and found him a job, and the daughter would have had some kind of husband and the child a father. But what now? It's embarrassing to even tell people the daughter got pregnant by a bum who, in addition, ran away somewhere. Oh, woe. Laughing stock for the chickens. The neighbors will laugh. Julia was painful to watch. She was constantly sick, could hardly eat anything, and at work she faced nothing but jibes and mockery, saying she got pregnant and doesn't even know the father. Especially the old cleaning ladies enjoyed elaborating on every detail, just give them a reason. Behind her back one could always hear, "Look at the youth today. They barely meet and jump into bed." Well, right, mischief is not tricky. It doesn't take much brain. Back in our time, nothing before marriage. Julia was angry and thought to herself, "Of course, in your time, there probably was no intimacy. People appeared out of thin air, and no one got burned, and no one was left. Some moralists have found themselves." The only person who treated her well was that very gynecologist, Mr. Montgomery. He always encouraged and calmed her. Julia, unable to bear the gossip, sometimes burst into tears right in his office. He didn't drive her away, scold her, or lecture her. He locked the door with a key and calmly said, "How about some tea with chocolate? Or a salty pickle? I always have it for my own. You, Julia, are in such a state now that you react very sharply to everything. And that's normal, hormones are playing, try to abstract away from everything. Walk more, talk to your son. I assure you, he hears and feels everything. You cry, and he feels bad there. You laugh, and he calms down in the womb. Believe me, when the baby's born, all the problems that now seem insurmountable to you will recede into the background. You will enjoy motherhood, and the rest is not so important. The situation is, of course, not simple, but no, if you have nowhere to go or need any help, you can always call me. You have my phone number. After each visit to the doctor, Julia wanted to live again. Another 2 months passed. There was not a single day and night that she didn't think of Jake. No matter how angry she was at him, she still loved him very much. The moment she closed her eyes, immediately his hands, lips, smile. She scolded herself for all she was worth. Throw him out, forget him. What a fool. He left you, went away, and doesn't remember. He doesn't care at all. If he truly loved me as I love him, he would have found a way to see me, to talk, to sort everything out. And since he agreed with everything and silently left forever, then that's where he belongs. So don't blame yourself. Thank you for the support. Now I can at least rest my soul at home. Mother and daughter embraced for the first time in a long time and cried. But these were tears of relief and liberation. A heavy burden of grievances, malice, and misunderstandings was lifted from both their hearts. Even, it seemed, breathing became easier. Mrs. Harrison bustled about, went to put on the kettle, and Julia crunched on a salty pickle, washing it down with sweet tea. The retiree recalled that when she was pregnant with her daughter, she literally ate chalk wherever she could find it. They both laughed. Now Mrs. Harrison was also actively preparing for Julia's childbirth. She took out an old dusty sewing machine from her youth, rummaged in a chest, and found a piece of soft flannel fabric, and began to remember her youth. In just a week, Mom sewed diapers, onesies, and caps. She washed them, ironed them, and neatly stacked them in a pile. Julia came from her shift and was amazed. She timidly took a tiny onesie in her hands, unfolded it, and tears of tenderness welled up in her eyes. "Mommy, thank you. How wonderful. So the baby will have such tiny hands, just like a doll's. It's hard to believe." Mom sighed and replied, "Yes, sweetie, we'll take turns staying up at night. It'll be hard at first, but then we'll get used to it. You can buy a stroller and a crib secondhand, look it up online. You'll get maternity benefits. It'll be enough for the first time, and maybe I'll stay with the grandson, and you can find some part-time job or go back to work earlier. We'll live through it." Julia felt morally much lighter. Now she knew that her mum was with her, supported her, and she could tell her what was bothering her, troubling her. And still, as soon as evening came, Julia became sad, thoughtful. Tears welled up and choked her. She remembered how she and Jake sat cuddled on the sofa watching a police series, and then slept together, clinging to each other. He tenderly stroked her shoulders, hair, whispered words of love. "Ah, Jake, how so? Where are you now? Maybe wandering around the world and have long forgotten me. How could you? I loved you so much. And you'll never know that you're about to have a son." These thoughts constantly churned in her head, wringing her soul without remainder. But soon, an event happened that shook the entire city and turned Julia's life upside down. That day, from the morning, she had a premonition. Something was stirring in her soul. Her heart was fluttering. She kept messing up at work and couldn't understand what was happening to her. She almost mixed up a patient's tests, then almost took the wrong patient to the X-ray. The head nurse yelled at Julia all day, "What's wrong with you? Pull yourself together, finally. What's going to happen before maternity leave if you're already daydreaming? Focus on work." When Julia came home from her shift, a procession of several luxurious black limousines pulled up to the house. Mrs. Harrison was just watering the flowers on the windowsill and was very surprised. "Look, daughter, what important big shots have come to someone. I've only seen such cars in movies. I wonder who they are. No rich people live in our building." Suddenly there was a knock at the door. Surprised, Mrs. Harrison went to open the door. Three bodyguards and one respectable, stylishly and expensively dressed young man stood on the doorstep. He smiled and asked, "Good afternoon, Mrs. Harrison. Is Julia home? May I come in?" Puzzled, the woman nodded and silently let the important guests in, wondering to herself who had come to them. The visitors went into the living room and Julia came out to meet them. Suddenly, this young and stylish dandy ran up to her and threw his arms around her. He was so joyful. "Hello, my love. Here I am, your Jacques. Are you happy? I've returned." To the guy's surprise, Julia pushed him away angrily and shouted, "What, Jake? And why have you decided to come back all of a sudden? You so easily gave up on me, believing what my mother told you and didn't even bother to talk to me personally, to find out if it was true or not. Where have you been all this time? In space? On the moon? Why haven't you ever let me know? What's with the limousine parade? Or was it a masquerade? And the bum image before? Who are you anyway?" The guy became sad, sat on the couch, gestured for the men to leave the room, and started to explain. "Don't be upset, darling. Please don't yell. Just hear me out. Yes, you're right, I'm no bum. I'm the son of the millionaire Jenkins. You've probably heard of him. We own two airlines abroad. So I grew up, of course, in luxury, wealth, attended a private elite school, then graduated from an economic school at Stanford. I thought life was ahead. It was beautiful and amazing. It felt like I had rose-colored glasses on. And suddenly, quite unexpectedly, I lost my mother. And that's despite her being very careful about her health, getting checked in the best clinics, and leading an absolutely healthy lifestyle. Can you imagine? She got out of the car, was walking to the supermarket, and right there a drunk driver managed to hit her to death. It was a terrible tragedy for our entire family. I vaguely remember the funeral. It seemed like it was all happening to someone else. At first, Dad grieved a lot. We somehow became closer. It was easier to get through such a heavy loss together. But Father shocked me when, 6 months after Mum's death, he brought this unbearable stepmother, Hope, into our house. I immediately had a bad feeling about her. She behaved arrogantly, bossed around our home, started throwing out Mum's things, removed her photos, although I strictly forbade her to do so. Eventually, a wild scandal broke out. I thought Dad would support me, but no. He sided with that villain and gave me an ultimatum. Either accept it or leave, unheard of, kicking out his own son from the house for some unbearable woman. I couldn't get through to my father. He seemed not to hear me. It felt like Hope had bewitched him. So I flared up and ran away from home, only to find myself completely unprepared for life on the street. What had I seen before? Luxurious life, high society, everything in abundance? I couldn't even imagine that people could go hungry, look for food in garbage chutes, sleep on heating mains. In my mind, those were alcoholics and outcasts of society. I was so scared, wandered, roamed. I was such a fool, I didn't even take documents from home. Then I realized, after talking to many of the homeless, that a good half of them are ordinary people, often even educated and well-read, just with a crippled fate. Meeting you, Julia, was the brightest episode in my vagrant life. When Mrs. Harrison kicked me out in frustration, I rushed to the station, jumped on a passing train, and ended up in Pittsburgh. There, as usual, I begged for alms near the station. When suddenly my father's procession picked me up right from there. Turns out Dad got very sick, caught a cold, and was hospitalized with pneumonia. Doctors barely managed to save him. So that snake immediately started dividing millions behind his back, rubbing her hands. She didn't visit him in the hospital even once. That's when Dad remembered he had a son. He was a shevid, decided to find me and apologize. We always lived soul to soul with him before this. Hope appeared, understood each other with half a word. Anyway, Dad and I made up. I now work as a manager in his company. I told Dad about you, Julia. He doesn't mind us meeting. So, I came for you. Get ready. We'll go to the city. I'll introduce you to my father. Julia sat, frowned, and was silent, then suddenly asked, I'm not going anywhere, Jake. First, my mom is sick, and I won't leave her for long. And secondly, I'm pregnant. How about that for news? The guy's face changed. Pregnant, I don't understand. By whom? Julia couldn't stand it, slapped him a resounding slap and shouted, Idiot! From the fiancé who I supposedly had. Are you hinting at that? So, you believed that I'm promiscuous, sleep with whoever, right? Well, go to hell, take your millions with you, I hate you. Julia ran to her room in tears. Enraged, Jake also jumped up. Oh, really? Well, goodbye then, such a hysterical woman. the entire procession left, Mrs. Harrison kept clutching her heart, understanding that this whole mess started because of her foolish words. She planted the seeds of doubt in Jake's head. And now how to fix everything? It's clear they love each other, yet they fight and argue as if they were enemies. 2 weeks passed. Julia fell into despair, cried day and night, and scolded herself for all she was worth. Why did I do that to him? He came back, returned, and I hit him in the face. Oh, what a fool I am, all because of stupid pride. I should have hugged him, kissed him, told him how much I love him, how much I missed him. And what? Now it's definitely over. No way out. Mrs. Harrison thought long about how to correct her mistakes and decided. She found out through acquaintances where the Jenkins lived and started making her way there. She lied through her teeth to her daughter. Julia, I'm going with Aunt Molly to the neighboring city to the hospital. She says a medical luminary, a professor, is coming there. I want to get a consultation with him. Maybe I can avoid surgery. I'll show all my exams and listen to what he says. Of course. Go, Mom. Can you manage on your own? Or should I go with you for support? Mrs. Harrison waved her hands. What are you, daughter, with your morning sickness, to such a distance to go? You'll be throwing up at every turn. No, you stay at home, rest, take care of my grandson, and don't cry all the time. It breaks my heart to see you like this. The city stunned the elderly woman. She found the Jenkins country mansion with great difficulty, spending her last savings on an expensive taxi. It was getting dark outside. Dense forests surrounded her. Mrs. Harrison became scared. What if they chase her away? How then to get home? No money left for the return journey. And it's a good distance to the public transport stop. The woman knocked on the gate. Huge dogs barked in the yard. A guard came out of the guardhouse and asked reluctantly, "Who are you looking for? Didn't get the address wrong?" Mrs. Harrison, taking a deep breath, answered, "I need to see Mr. Jenkins, or his son Jake. I have important personal business with them. Just tell them that." The guard communicated with the owner via radio. "Mr. Jenkins, there's some elderly woman asking for you. Says it's personal and important. Should I let her in?" From the other end of the line it was heard, "Let her introduce herself. Who is she? I don't know any women." The senior stated, "I'm Mrs. Harrison, mother of Julia Harrison, Jake's fiance. Tell them I won't leave. I'll freeze here till morning if I have to, but I won't go until they talk to me." The guard relayed all this to the owner, who sighed and replied, "Well, all right. Bring her to my office. I'll come down now." Mrs. Harrison timidly entered the lavishly furnished office. A stern, imposing man in glasses sat behind the desk. He gestured for the guest to sit down. Then he coughed and asked, "So, madam, what brings you here? Who are you?" "You say." "Because I didn't quite understand from the guard's words." The woman answered, "I'm Mrs. Harrison, Julia's mother. You see, about 4 months ago, my daughter brought home a bum, said he was her fiancé, named Jake, and he would live with us. Of course, I was totally against it. Julia is such a homegirl. Before this incident, she only had one boyfriend, Anthony, and that was a year ago. Otherwise, she's a smart girl, works as a nurse at our local hospital. So, I got sidetracked. Of course, I was absolutely opposed to those relationships. Julia and Jake had a terrible love affair with all the ensuing consequences. Everything was going well for them. And I, with these very hands, ruined everything. I couldn't stand the thought of my smart and beautiful daughter getting involved with a bum. I've lived a hard life myself. Didn't want the same for my daughter. I spun some tall tales out of anger. Now Jake is having doubts. What to do? I have no idea. We don't want anything from you. Don't get me wrong. We'll raise the child ourselves. But I just want to ask your son for forgiveness and explain to him that those words of mine were a lie. Julia had no one else. It's sad that two loving hearts are in dispute because of me. It's also sad for the grandson. He won't get to know his own father. Please tell this to Jake. And if possible, could you take me to the station? I need to go home. Julia doesn't know I came to you. She'll worry, and she shouldn't." The man took off his glasses, twisted them in his hands, then replied, "What a piece of news. So I'm going to be a grandfather soon?" "Well, Jake, our troublemaker has been everywhere. Now the picture is more or less clear, I guess. I was wondering why he's been gloomier than the clouds. Don't worry. I'll talk to my son. The chauffeur will take you straight home now. It's just an hour's drive in a good car. Mrs. Harrison sighed with relief. Thank you for not kicking me out, for listening and understanding. You can immediately see that you are a calm and thoughtful person. Not like all of us. First, we create problems, and then we think. With a light heart, Mrs. Harrison was going home. Now her conscience was clear. She tried to do everything to reconcile Jake and Julia, and to atone for her sins. When Jake came home from work, he was so tired that the only thought was to fall down and sleep, but it was not to be. His father was already waiting for him in the corridor. Jake remembered well from childhood this look of his father, eyebrows knit together and glasses on the tip of his nose, meaning there was going to be a serious talk. And so it was. Alfred told his son, "Let's go to the office, son. We need to talk." Jake sighed and reluctantly followed, wondering what he was going to get into this time. As soon as the office door closed, the father began strictly, "What's happening, Jake?" "It turns out my son is a scoundrel, and I knew nothing about it." Jake was so shocked by this turn of events. "What, Dad? What did I do? Everything's fine in the company. The contracts are in order. I double-checked everything today. What got into you?" The man got even more heated. "Such a thing, son. Her name is Mrs. Harrison. A woman came today, cried, asked for your forgiveness. She said her daughter is pregnant by you. How should I understand this? If it's true, why are you hiding in the bushes right away? Is that manly?" Jake immediately hung his head and frowned. "I don't know, Dad. What to do? You see, Julia, she's good, kind. I love her so much. She helped me then, sheltered me. Otherwise, I would have frozen there in the underpass. But her mother, a sneaky snake, she always buzzed in my ear that I'm not her match. And then she kicked me out altogether. Told me that Julia is with me just for fun, but she actually has a fiancé. Well, I got offended. And when last week I decided to come to Julia to reconcile, instead of being happy and hugging me, she hit me in the face. Well, is that normal? And for what? Just for a simple question, whose child she is pregnant with? Well, I need to be sure that it's my child. You never know." The father shook his head. "Oh, Jake, your head is filled with nonsense. I would also love to smack you in the face right now. First, how could you blindly believe in women's gossip and not check? You should have definitely waited for Julia and talked everything out with her. Second, just think about it. What would 99% of girls do, knowing you're the son of a millionaire? They would be bending over backwards just to be with you, right? And what about yours? She slapped you and kicked you out, right? What does that tell you? It means she doesn't give a damn about your money and status. For her, the truth is more important. If she dared to bring a homeless guy home despite her mother and to love him, it means it's for real, understand? And you started doubting her." Jake completely wilted. "Indeed, how did I not think of this? And I've been torturing myself. I love her so much and am so jealous, though I don't even know of whom. I feel so bad without her. You know, she's really my person. Since I met Julia, I don't want to look at anyone else. And what now, Dad? She's too proud. She probably won't forgive me." Mr. Jenkins laughed. "Fool! Her mother said that your bride has been crying her eyes out day and night, doesn't want to see anyone, drenches herself in tears, and you, she won't forgive you. Just talk to heart sincerely, hug her, propose to her. No woman would refuse that. And you, just think of it, wanted to deprive a grandfather of his grandson." Inspired, Jake bought a bunch of red roses, a huge shirami cake, which Julia had always dreamed of trying, and rushed to her house again. He timidly rang the doorbell. Julia's mother came out. She looked very bad and was slightly staggering. The young man greeted her. "Good afternoon, Mrs. Harrison. Is Julia home? I need to talk to her." Suddenly, the woman burst into tears. "Hello, Jake. Julia was taken to the hospital just half an hour ago. An ambulance took her. She had severe stomach pain and bleeding started. Oh, what a misfortune. God forbid a miscarriage. It's all because of her nerves. She completely wore herself out. I wanted to go with her too, but the doctor talked me out of it. My blood pressure jumped to almost 200. Here, I'm lying down. Tomorrow morning, I'll run to her. I hope it all goes well. I'll never forgive myself. Jake turned pale and changed color. Idiot! Fool! It's all because of me. Which hospital? Give me the address, quickly. The young man flew at full speed, not caring for the road. When he burst into the reception, the nurses were stunned. It's not every day that the son of Jenkins himself stops by. They often saw Jake on advertising banners and magazine covers and immediately recognized him. The young man almost shouted, "In which room is Harrison Julia lying? What's with her? Where's the attending physician? She's my fiancée." The staff scurried about. Everyone tried to calm Jake down. The elderly, tired doctor came out of the doctor's office and strictly said, "What are you doing here?" "This is a maternity hospital, not a market, by the way. Ms. Harrison is in the fifth room. The situation, to be honest, is critical. Threat of miscarriage, severe bleeding. We're doing everything we can. Are you the father of the child? Can you donate blood? It would really help her now, as the blood loss is significant." Jake nodded his head. "Yes, anything, just so Julia and the baby are all right. I'll pay for any, the most expensive drugs. I beg you, let me see her for a second. It's important for me to tell her something. When she hears this, everything will be fine, I assure you." The doctor was about to say that it's not allowed, but looking into the young man's eyes, full of pain and despair, he changed his mind. "Okay, just a couple of minutes, and I'm waiting for you in the treatment room." Jake quietly entered the room. Julia lay there, frightened and pale as a sheet, and it seemed she was barely breathing. Medical staff bustled around her, giving injections and setting up an IV with medications. The young man approached her, knelt down, and whispered, "Hi, my little bird. Forgive me, fool. I love you so much, more than life. Don't say anything. Conserve your strength and our babies. Let me put my hand on your stomach, may I?" He carefully placed his hand on the lower abdomen, gently stroked it, and murmured, "My little son, it's me, your daddy. Don't make trouble there. We love you and are waiting for you very much. You are needed exactly on time, strong and healthy." A nurse appeared at the door and gestured that it was time to go. Jake tenderly kissed Julia and left. And something unimaginable was happening in her soul. Just an hour ago, she just wanted to die, and basically she didn't care what would happen next, but now inside everything was filled with warmth, happiness, and incredible light. She so wanted to live, to love Jake, to raise a son. She finally closed her eyes and fell asleep. Knowing now everything will be all right, she's not alone, Jake is with her, Jake donated blood. The poor guy spent the whole night sitting on the couch in the lobby, not closing his eyes, and prayed as best he could. "Lord, take everything from me. Money, the company, cars. Just let Julia and the baby recover. Let me get sick instead if something happens to them. I love them so much." In the morning, the same tired doctor touched his shoulder. He had already changed and was going home. Looking at the unhappy young man, he felt so sorry for him and decided to cheer him up. "Jake, everything's fine with your fiancée. We managed to stop the bleeding. The threat of miscarriage has been averted, but she will need to stay with us for another week or two to be observed. In the future, be careful, avoid stress, nervous strains, take care of her. Women are a delicate breed, especially in such a condition. If you want, you can pay for a private room with the TV." The happy Jake was shaking the doctor's hand, thanking him. "Thank you, thank God everything turned out well. If something happened to Julia or the baby, I would never forgive myself. Can I see her now?" The doctor strictly replied, "Visiting hours are posted in the reception. Don't break the regime. These rules are written for everyone. Clear." Jake arranged everything, and Julia was transferred to a separate, comfortable room with a TV. She was still not allowed to get up, so the young man tried to spend every free minute with her. He gave her massages, stroked her belly, overwhelmed her with fruits, juices, and vitamins. Mom also regularly brought homemade borscht and steamed cutlets. Julia couldn't be happier. "Mom, Jake, you're going to completely fatten me up. I'll become plump as Winnie the Pooh." Especially since the morning sickness has already passed, and a wolfish appetite has woken up. "I eat like there's no tomorrow." After being discharged from the hospital, Jake, despite Julia's protests, moved her to his mansion. And he, together with his father, took care of Mrs. Harrison's health. They sent her for treatment to a health resort and paid for a month's stay there. The woman was happy. After all, she never really rested anywhere in her entire life. As soon as there was a vacation at work, she immediately looked for a side job year after year. And there was never so much money to go to resorts. The sanatorium was located on the southern seacoast. The landscapes were simply magnificent. The staff pampered her like a queen. Well, yes, an important guest. The mother-in-law of Jenkins himself. The woman walked a lot, took photos against the backdrop of mountains and beaches, and sent the pictures to her friends. They were green with envy. The whole entrance was gossiping. Look how lucky Margaret got in her old age, resting like a queen, treated for free. Here's to you, Julia. And then everyone criticized her. Stupid girl, got involved with a bum. But the bum turned out to be not just any bum, just like in a fairy tale. Julia went on maternity leave at work and decided to organize a farewell lunch in the staff room on her last day. She brought cake, juice, fruits, and champagne for her colleagues. Now no one laughed at her anymore, no one gossiped. But everyone was flattering and trying to please. After all, you never know. She might complain to her father-in-law, then wait for all kinds of inspections. In the countryside, Julia felt great. Fresh forest air, walks along shady paths, relaxation in the gazebo, deep sleep. She rounded up, prettified, her cheeks became rosy, her belly grew not by days but by hours, and resembled a huge watermelon. Jake pampered his beloved like a crystal vase. He was so happy. He prearranged with the best clinic for the upcoming childbirth, constantly asked about her well-being, and worried that, God forbid, the threat of miscarriage would not repeat. Mr. Jenkins also didn't waste time, ordered new furniture, equipped a chic nursery, but he kept it all a secret from the young ones and showed nothing, worrying that it was a bad omen. Mrs. Harrison healed well and rejuvenated. When she went for a checkup at her clinic, the doctors were amazed, so much so that her indicators had improved. The doctor was surprised. Mrs. Harrison, now you can even get married. What was the name of that sanatorium? I will recommend it to all my patients. When Julia went for the last prenatal ultrasound with her beloved, they were in for another shock. Mr. Montgomery, smiling slyly, began, Julia, I see everything's fine in your personal life. Is this your husband? You look good. Touch wood. The woman beamed. Yes, this is Jake, the father of my baby. Everything's great with us. Mr. Montgomery continued, Then I have some amazing news for you. Young man, you might want to sit down just in case. The frightened Jake blurted out, Something with the baby. Tell me, don't drag it out. You're having twins, a boy and a girl. Congratulations. Julia was so stunned. Twins? But I had three ultrasounds during my pregnancy, and you never mentioned twins. How come? Mr. Montgomery continued, Yes, I saw everything. Just decided not to scare you for the time being. Admit it, if I had told you about this, would you have agreed not to terminate the pregnancy? You were already scared and always crying. Jake jumped with joy. Wow, that's something. Right away, two kids. That's great. We'll be done at once, right, Julia? It won't be boring for sure. The shocked Julia replied, Definitely, and for everyone. And here I was wondering why my baby was making so much fuss. And my belly is like two watermelons. Will I be able to give birth on my own, or will I have to have surgery? The gynecologist laughed. Here we go. Typical female fears. Of course you'll give birth on your own. Your indicators are normal, the pelvis is wide. We'll manage. Don't worry. You'll just have to be admitted to the maternity hospital a week earlier. As with twins, childbirth often occurs prematurely and rapidly. Everyone at home was shocked. Mrs. Harrison secretly crossed herself and thought to herself, God, it's so good that Julia and Jake reconciled. I can't imagine how we would have managed to raise two children together. The happy Julia snuggled up to Jake and dreamily replied, See, when I first saw you in the underpass, I somehow immediately thought this is my destiny, God's honest truth, and I wasn't wrong. Jake kissed Julia and replied, I've thought about it so many times. If I hadn't quarreled with my father then and hadn't been wandering in the underpass, we probably would never have met. I don't regret for a second that we met. I only regret that I was such a fool and made my bunny suffer so much that we almost lost our babies. Forgive me again. Now I know for sure, no matter the circumstances, we should always sit down and talk. We still have a lot to learn. Our family has just formed, but we have a whole life ahead of us. Julia barely made it to the end of her pregnancy. By the end, she couldn't see anything beyond her nose over her huge belly. When Julia was taken to the maternity hospital, Jake was restless, pacing the corridor, wringing his hands and worrying. Mrs. Harrison prayed alongside him. Looking at his daughter-in-law's huge belly, Mr. Jenkins couldn't even grasp how women managed to give birth, and especially to two at once. Fortunately, everything went well. Julia insisted that only Mr. Montgomery would deliver the babies. She trusted him 100% and knew he wouldn't harm her. When they handed her two squealing bundles, completely wet and exhausted, everything seemed unbelievable. The hearts of both the young parents and the grandparents were filled with immense joy and love for the new little lives that had just begun their journey in their big, loving family. At that moment, Julia felt like the happiest woman on the planet. Mr. Montgomery leaned over to her and slyly said, "Remember what I promised you. That when you become a mum, happiness will fill you so much that all other problems and difficulties will seem so minor and unimportant." So, was I right? Julia blissfully smiled. "You're right by 100%. Thank you for everything, Mr. Montgomery. You've become more than a doctor to me. You've been like a father during this time, my deepest gratitude to you." At the christening of Mary and Steve, all the honorable people gathered. The press, reporters, they invited Mr. Montgomery and all acquaintances. It was a feast for the whole world. Everyone marveled at the little angels quietly cooing in their cradle, wishing the happy family happiness and goodness.